I invite Professor C. Malla Reddy to introduce Professor B. N. Jagtap, our next speaker.
Yeah, thank you, Vivek. Thank you very much. So since we are running a bit late, like I think about 10, 15 minutes, so I quickly introduce without taking much time. So I give more time to the speakers so that we enjoy the talks. So Professor B. N. Jagtap is currently with the Department of Physics, IIT Bombay. So he had a long journey at the BARC, you know, so he spent about 40 years there as a scientist. And in 2016, he moved to IIT Bombay. Before that, he was a distinguished scientist and director, chemical group at BARC. So without taking much time, so I request Professor B. N. Jagtap to take over.
Thank you, Professor Reddy, for being brief. And let me also thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. In the next 30 minutes, I'm going to give you a real brief overview of developments in chemistry in India. And this period is almost about 3,000 years. And I'm very happy that the distinguished guest raised many points. And I have included answers to some of those points or observations to those points in my presentation. So let me begin at the next. The timeline for development of chemical sciences is prehistoric to something about 1600 AD. That's where the modern chemistry begins. And this period is roughly divided into five segments. The first one is the Vedic period up to 600 AD. This is where the medicinal and metallurgical chemistry had its birth. Then is 600 BCE to 800 common era is the Ayurvedic period, where lots of principles of medical sciences were established and put in the rational basis. Then comes the period 800 to 1100 AD. This is called as the transitional period. This is where largely the metal oxides, metal sulfides, metal related medicines were introduced in the medical practices. And this is called the transition period. Then comes the Tantric period, 1100 to 1300 AD. This is a very peculiar period which mixed up the chemistry with the Tantric cult in the worship of Shiva and Parvati. It's a mystic one, but lots of chemistry, useful chemistry was done. And that useful chemistry was used in the iatrochemical period, 1300 to 1550 in India. Now, before we begin, let's have some idea who were this ancient chemist and what are their manuscripts which are available to us. And I will request you to watch out the names of these manuscripts, and that essentially tells you how the chemistry as a discipline and somewhere later as an independent discipline has evolved. The Vedic period, you have Agnivesha, Parashara, Bhela, Jatukarma, Kshirapani. And they have all written their Samhitas. The Parashara's Vriksha Ayurveda, very important book for botany. I have included here Kapila, Sankhya Sutra. The reason is I would connect it with the Vaisheshika Sutra of Kannada a little later. And one of the disciples of Kapila, the Prashastapada, is the first one to write a book, Padartha Dharma Sangraha. And then you have the Ayurvedic period led by Charaka and Sushruta. Then Kannada gives the idea of an atom, Vagbhata, Umaswati. Varahamihira, he gives lots of, in his Brihatsanhita, talks about all these constellations and all that, but he also talks about chemistry. Patanjali does talk about it. And Kautilya have included here because Arthashastra has the involvement, how the state is involved in chemistry and metallurgy. And you can see all these manuscripts, they appear to be general except for the Charaka, Sushruta, Vagbhata and Umaswati, and where the chemistry knowledge enters into in some context. But when we begin with the transition period, now here, first time you start getting the word Rasa, the Nagarjuna's Rasaratnakara, of course, the Kakapushta Yantra, Arogya Manjari, Yoga Sara, or Gangadhara's Gandhasara, Chakrapani Datta, he's basically a medical practitioner, but lots of chemistry was done. In the Tantric period, Now you see that rasa appearing almost everywhere. There is a vakbhata, rasa ratna samuchaya, rasa arnava, rasa hradaya, sarveshwa rasayana, hatuvat rasa hradaya, then rasendra chintamani. You can see, add some word like chudamani, chintamani, sudhakara, and you write a book on chemistry. Rasa prakasha, sudhakara, rasa chintamani, Ananta Deva's contribution. Remember one thing in Sanskrit, rasa is also used for mercury. And that you start finding in the tantric period, because the mercury was one mystic element and everybody wanted to work on it. And in the iatrochemical period, you have several of these chemists writing their manuscripts, and you can, from Nityananda to Govinda Dasa, and look at the titles of their manuscript. Rasaratnakara, this is Nityananda's Rasaratnakara, Rasaraja Lakshmi, Rasasara, Rasa Nakshatra Malika, and Rasa Komodi, and there is Shalinatha writes his Dhatukriya, Rasamanjiri, and so forth. So you can see the tradition of chemists, but remember one thing, these are not all the chemists which are mentioned in our tradition. There exist several other chemists which we cannot put them in those right periods, right from Anandabhava, Bhojadeva. For example, there is Gorakshanatha here, is written Goraksha Sanhita and Sarveshwara Siddhanta. Whether is the same Gorakshanath or some other Gorakshanath, we still have no idea. The Kankali, Keshavadev, Mallari, and so many people and their manuscripts. And on top of that, there are several other chemists which are described in these manuscripts, like Balabhadra, Brahmajyoti, Mahanandanatha, Manthana Bhairava, and Swachanda Bhairava. These nine names keep coming very often, and Nandi. Now the younger generation would ask this question, how do we know this? How do we know this chemistry tradition? Now, as for this, I have brought this from Rasaratna Samuchaya, the first chapter, after the initial salutation to gods. This Prathamodhyaya begins like this: Adima, Chandrasena, Lankesha. I'm not going to read all that. Visharada, Kapali, Matta, Mandava, Bhaskara. And it ends up to Hari. So you can see here in the Sanskrit Shloka, Hari. These are the 27 experts of Rasashastra. Saptam Vishanti Sankhyaka Rasamidi Pradayaka. And on top of that, Bhairava, Nandi, Swachanda Bhairava, Manthana Bhairava, Kaka Chandeshwari, Kandeshwara, Vasudeva, Rishi Shinga, the compilers of Rishi Shastra, and those ascetic Rasendra Tilaka, Valuki, who got the application of Maithili, Mahadeva, Narendra, Vasudeva, and Harishwara. So you can see the four generations of chemists from where this knowledge was acquired by the author is now described here. And then at the end, he says, this treatise, Rasaratna Samuchaya, is compiled by Srihagupta after having consulted the works of aforesaid experts and others. So now we know the tradition. The India had a great tradition of the chemists. So I have shown you the names and the type of manuscripts they have written. Now we can superimpose this knowledge, what we have, onto the archaeological and historical evidences, and say that whatever the major developments in the history of chemistry in India. Well, this is just a list. I'll take some examples little later. From 2500 to 1800 BC, you have the gold, silver, copper, lead, silver, gold alloy, some minerals, glaze potteries, porcelain, art of dyeing, copper mines, the Rajasthan, they have been carbon dated, lost wax casting. 1500 to 800 BC, the copper smelting, iron technology in some form, extraction of tin, making of glass, fermentation, tanning, medicinal chemistry has been always the theme. 600 to 400 BC, plus some alloys, brass, then the steel, colored glasses, ink, amalgams, vegetable dyes, and here enters Kanada, the atomic theory, concepts of compound formation. The important historical evidence is 400 BC, where King Puru presents steel to Alexander. Indian steel was so famous and so valuable that King Puru presents steel to Alexander. From 100 to 400 CE, the chemical combination, preparations of alkali, use of minerals in medicine, it began there. Relation between heat and chemical changes. 370, 375, another archaeological evidence, the iron pillar, which is pure wrought iron fabricated at Mathura, and it was shifted to Delhi in 1050 AD. 400 to 600 common era, we have the pure copper, process of hardening of steel, arsenic, and cosmetics. Another archaeological evidence is 500 CE, the statue of Gautam Buddha, 7 feet 6 inches. It's a pure copper, 99.7% copper, weighing about a ton, was fabricated. 600 CE, the wood steel for making high quality swords exported to Damascus. This export started from 600 AD and Syria. And today's language, we know it is a microcarbide within tempered martensite. 800 to 900 CE, the extraction of zinc from calamine, use of mercury sulfide in medicine, advanced knowledge of gemstones. 1000 CE is paper making. And then 1100 to 1200, soap, indelible ink, sulfuric acid, antimony from sibnite, classification of chemicals, laboratory practices, and from 1300 to 1600, the medical use of calomel, blended perfumes, aqua regia, and some exotic copper, lead, zinc, tin alloy. Now, this has been the progress which is superimposed on the knowledge and archaeological and historical evidences. Let me take few representative examples, because all what I have said is just a compilation. Now, just look at this verse from Yajurveda. The important thing here to know is that what is talked here is not only gold, iron, and copper, but lead and tin. You can see here, sisam chame, trapu chame, yadnena kalpana. Then in Chandogya Upanishada, there is also a reference. Now this verse comes in a very interesting way. The author starts writing that, well, if you are doing a yagya and if there is a discontinuity, then you can join the two pieces of yagya. How do you join? Just as one would join gold by salt, silver by gold, tin by silver, lead by tin, iron by lead, wood by iron. So it gives you all those metallurgical, how do you join two metals. Now, Sushruta Sanhita gives you details of preparation of alkali. Let me just read it out for you. Some well-grown trees in the forest are cut into logs and piled in a place free from the strong wind. Limestone seashells should be placed on the pile and then set on the fire by stalk of dry plant. When all the wood is burnt out, the fire extinguished, the ashes of the logs and the burnt lime are collected and kept separate and then dissolved in water separately. The extract of ashes is then mixed with lime water to get the lye, which is separated by the precipitate by filtration. The solution is concentrated to different extent by boiling, and it is possible to get dilute, mild, and caustic alkali. Well, this particular experiment was done by Acharya Praful Chandra Ray himself. He took one of the vanaspatis which was mentioned in this is Apamarga, and he takes his leaves, stem, and root and does the elemental analysis as a modern chemist. And he finds that in the leaves, stems, and roots, this is the number which is not visible to you, the K2O, potassium oxide, is 17.8% in leaves, 32% in the stem, and roots it is 28.58%. That means if you dissolve K2O, you should get KOH. But the process which is described is very interesting. You heat it with the shells. So once you heat it, calcium carbonate decomposes to give you calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. That carbon dioxide reacts with the potassium oxide, which is from the ashes, produces potassium carbonate. And this calcium oxide, if you put separately in water, it gives you calcium hydroxide, calcium carbonate, and calcium hydroxide gives you potassium hydroxide and calcium carbonate. So you filter it out, and the filtered solution is indeed KOH. So there's no magic in it. It is straight away the chemistry. Only thing is this alkali is derived from the plant sources. Now, a large number of alloys are described, and this is one very interesting one, not often quoted from the Brihat Samhita, a mixture consisting of 8 parts of lead, 2 parts of bell metal, and 1 of iron rust has been mentioned by Maya, the great Maya, and it is to be known as Vajra Sangata, the diamond-like hard compound. And other alloys like bronze, which have been mentioned like Ashtabhagena Tamrena Dvibhaga Kutilena cha, the bronze is obtained by melting 8 parts of copper and 2 parts of tin together. Rasaratnakara gives you lots of interesting ideas on purification of metals, and some of these processes are used even today. Nagena Kshara Rajena, that is the impure silver, is purified by melting it with lead and ashes, the oxides. Rasaranava talks about the reaction of sulfur with metals, and the way the poetically it has been put, nasti tallohan matango, that is yannad gandhaka keshari, there is no metal that cannot be killed by a lion called sulfur. And this is one which I like the most. This is from Rasaranava. Now see the language in which it has been put, since we are talking about the national education policy and the teaching methods. The first line is Shrunu Lohanyataha Param. That is, oh goddess, listen to me what I am saying about the metals. Loha is a word which is used for the metals and not for iron. I'll explain to you little later. And the way the verse goes as Suvarnam Rajatam Tamram Tikshanam Vangam Bhujangamam Lohantu Shadivanam Tacha Yatha Purva Tadakshayam. That is silver, gold, silver, copper, iron, tin, and lead. These are the 6 metals, and their resistance to rusting is in the order in which I have told you. The Suvarnam Rajatam, Suvarna is more resistant than silver, so and so forth. And since I talked about the iron, well, the iron is referred in a very different context, where they had 3 varieties of iron, the Mundaloha, Tikshnaloha, and Kantaloha, the cast iron, wrought iron, and carbon steel. So wherever there is a reference, it will be said as Mundam, Tikshnam, or Kantam, not as Loha. Loha is to be taken for the metals. The flame test existed. Of course, they were working with the crucibles and fire, and so there were observations on the various types of flames. The Avartamane Kanake Pitata Re Sita Prabha, the translation is here. The colors of the flames of the metals are gold gives yellow color, silver gives white color, copper gives blue color, wrought iron gives black color, tin gives ash color, and so on and so forth. The important thing is the diamond, which will give the thermoluminescence, so many colors. So all these observations are recorded. One of the interesting chemical which is produced in the ancient India for the first time is calomel, Hg2Cl2. And this has been described at length by many texts, the Bhava Prakasha or Rasa Prakasha Sudhakara. You take the purified mercury and gairika is the word used for iron oxide, alum plus rock salt plus kharilavana, that is sodium sulfate, and take red earth, place on fire a pot containing this mixture and heat for 4 days. The pot is covered with a lid. White camphor like solid deposited on upper part is the desired product. This is a rasa karpura. Rasa is mercury, karpura is camphor. So this is what was called as a rasa karpura. Now, with a little chemistry knowledge, now you can understand what really they were doing. Using that gairika, iron oxide, alum, rock salt, kharilavana, they're trying to produce a nascent chlorine, which then reacts with the purified mercury and gives you Hg2Cl2. And most likely, in this gairika would act like a catalyst in the whole process. The zinc extraction, which has been known, and it's a separate talk on this, I'm not going to discuss this, but something which I would like to point it out here, this is a description in the Rasaratna Samuchaya, which is an identical procedure has been described in Rasaratnakara, Dhatuvad, Rasa Prakasha, Sudhakara, Rasa Chintamani, and etc. Now, the The first two lines are important. What it says is that you take that calamine, that is zinc ore, add this turmeric, resin, soot, and all that, that's fine. And then say, Musham Mushopari Tasya Karparam Pradametata. That is, close the crucible's mouth with another inverted over it. So it's, what they're doing is the downward distillation of zinc and apply heat. That's fine. And then look at the empirical facts, how they are recorded. Karpare prachvalate jwala bhaven nila sita yadi. When you lit the whole thing, initially the flame is going to be blue. And when it becomes white, say that your product is ready. The your reaction is over. Now this experiments, this production is done in under low oxygen partial pressures. So initially you have only carbon monoxide, which burns with the blue flame. And when all that carbon monoxide is used for reduction of the zinc ore, then the flame will turn white. So all these facts and how that is to be collected is also mentioned there. Now, there are some observations people make. The Westerners call Indian alchemy. So we should also ask this question. Was it really alchemy? Indian chemistry did not start for converting any base metal to the gold, like the Western chemistry started. It started for the health purposes, making metals, medicinal chemistry, and so on and so forth. But somewhere down the line, some references are brought to us and told that, look, this is alchemy. Now, let me explain a little bit on this. This is the first one is from Rasaratnagara. And again, see the language. What wonder it is that calamine roasted thrice with copper converts the latter into gold. Now, what is the process he's describing? Calamine is a zinc ore. Now, it was known that the calamine, if you start reducing in air, the zinc will oxidize. So what is the best way of doing that? You roast copper with calamine so that that nascent zinc gets absorbed in the hot copper and you turn it into brass. Now, why do you want to do it thrice? Because this whole process will be limited by the zinc content of your ore, and therefore you want to the high bright brass, then you need to roast it thrice. Now, what he was really talking about was converting copper into brass. But then it is mistakenly taken, you go onto the internet, there's a Nagarjuna, the Indian alchemist, is not an alchemist. Because the same Nagarjuna provides you the process for separating zinc from calamine. Another one is from the Dhatu Kriya. Now, let me read the English translation. Tin to be melted and 100 part of its weight of mercury to be amalgamated with it. This silver can be used for exchange and one can amass wealth fraudulently. The next sloka says is a fraudulent. So the intention here is not to convert tin into silver, but look, it will have the appearance of silver. And well, the mischievous people can make money by exchanging it for silver. We all know about Kanada, the founder of Vaisheshika system, who provided the idea of atom. But there are a few more things we should know, and that those references come from Varahamihira's Brihat Sanhita. And I find this is very interesting. Now, the way he says is, let me again read the translation for you. This is a translation from Subramanya Swami Shastri. The smallest particle of dust that comes to sight when the sun passes through the interstice of a window is to be known as an atom. It was known that atom is an invisible particle. But then from the light coming from the window, if you see so many particles which are floating around, then Varahamihira says, well, this could be an atom. And this can be called at the smallest unit of all measures. This is the first time somebody uses light scattering experiment to measure the microscopic sizes. But the next sloka is more interesting. Then he measures the size of that particle. How does he do it? It is not given. But an atom, a dust particle, hair strip, and all that, all these are 8 times bigger than the preceding measure. So essentially what it means is the size of an atom is a dust particle by 8, hair tip by 64, and so on and so forth. And if you put the numbers, one barley corn is 1/3 of an inch, What he measures is 0.25 micron, and that's the size of an aerosol particle. So he was on the ditto right by his light scattering experiment, but he thought it was something, it was an atom. Now, I'll come to the last part of it, which I'll finish very fast. The chemistry and metallurgy was an organized activity in ancient India. And why I say organized is, penetrated to all the classes and in the society. Also, when the field matures, it develops its own classification and standardization. The chemistry moves from laboratory test tubes to the industrial production. And also society benefits by the development of professional skills related to chemistry and metallurgy. And there is a foreign trade. And finally, it's the social welfare and the material prosperity. And we see how the chemistry and metallurgy has covered all this. The classification of chemicals, our chemists did classification in 10 classes. Of course, this classification is entirely different what we know, but it was a useful classification for them. Then they also described the chemical apparatus. There are all kinds of distillation units and all kinds of crucibles are described. And I'll just bring one thing here, the Tiryaka Pathanayan from the downward distillation, which was used right from Chanakya's time. And look at the description. Tradespeople fraudulently adulterate mercury with lead and tin. Hence, it is to be freed from these impurities by means of three distillations as given in Tiryaka Pathanayan. So this is not only the liquids which were distilled, these are metals were distilled by the people. And this process of Tiryaka Pathanayan Yantram played a pivotal role in the zinc extraction. How to establish chemical laboratories, detailed exposition is given. The chemical laboratory must be established at a place where there exists plenty of medicinal plants and water. And from this shloka, you can figure out where to keep the cutting, where should be the stone equipments and all that. But the important thing is this. Instruction is those who are truthful, free from temptation, and are well-versed with the knowledge of drugs, plants, and languages of many countries should be employed in the rasashala. So the first thing is they need to be honest. Chemistry has to be done by honest people. Science has to be done by honest people. As well as the people should be well-versed with the languages of many countries. And that also talks about the trade relationship with the countries. And just to give you a flavor, Rasakalpa, at the end of that treatise, he writes, I have performed these experiments with my own hands and have seen them with my own eyes. They are not recorded from mere hearsay or from the direction of teacher. These are being told for the benefit of mankind. The industrial skill production, we know, iron pillar, which weighs 6 tons, the iron pillar at Dhar is 7 tons. The zinc melting furnaces, which were unearthed from Zawar, huge industrial production was going on those days. And this is what James Ferguson said in 1897. Hindus at that age, 400 AD, were capable of forging a bar of iron larger than any that have been forged even in Europe up to a very late date, and not frequently even now. And on the right side, you see the zinc smelting furnaces, which were unearthed at Zawar. And it is estimated that in 500 years, 1 lakh ton of zinc was produced from these mines. The mining and metal extraction was a state activity. And this is, I'm quoting from the Kautilya's Arthashastra. You can see the first word is Akaradaksha. Akaradaksha is the superintendent of mine. Now, who is the superintendent of mine? Having knowledge of science dealing with copper and other minerals, experience in the art of distillation and condensation of mercury, and of testing gems, aided by experts in mineralogy and equipped with mining laborers and necessary instruments, shall examine mines which, on account of their containing mineral, crucible, charcoal, ashes, may appear have to be once exploited or which may be newly discovered. So he has to ascertain that. And he has to ascertain the richness of that ore by weight, depth of color, smell, and taste. In the same thing, he will start talking about the superintendent of metal shall carry on the manufacture of copper, lead, mercury, brass, bronze, bellmetal, arsenic, and also of the commodities from them. Loha Bhanda Vyavaharam Cha. And the superintendent of mint shall carry on the manufacture of silver coins, Rupya Rupam, that is the Rupaya, now we what we use, made of 4 parts of copper and 1/16 part of any metal that is given here, Tikshna Trappu Sisa, that is either iron, tin, or lead. The mineral resources were documented. This is an extract from Dhatu Kriya, Dhatu Manjiri. It says that you can read this at Nepal, Kamrupa, copper is ores are at Nepal, Kamrupa, Wanga, the countries of Lenchas, Rumas, and Ferengis. The zinc can be, zinc is available in Kamboj, Roma, and Balk. Development of skills and profession, very important one. In India, we say that there are 16 Vidyas and 64 Kalas. What are those 64 Kalas? Well, Vatsayana and Shushruta have listed them. This is 600 BC. And you'll be surprised to see what are those Kalas. Examination and valuation of gold and gems. Art of alloying and separating metals. Art of extracting alkali. Knowledge of coloring of gems and jewels. Knowledge of mines and quarries, art of piercing and incinerating stones and metals, knowledge of combination of metals, herbs and plants. So these were all the traits and skills those were developed in the society. And this also obviously gave rise to a great foreign trade. The Indian craftsmen acquired mastery and made innovations so that Indian products like metals, particularly Indians had in, they did a lot of metallurgy and metal sciences. But coloring of metals were very special to India. And that is where all the swords which were sent abroad, they required those nice coloring. It was done in India. Cotton, paper, cotton, the dyes were important for that. Cosmetics, perfumes, dye stuffs, medicines, glass, porcelain goods, they became much valued and preferred items in foreign countries. And here I will bring just short picture. Much is talked about the Damascus sword. And the material used to be taken from India. But recently when these Damascus swords were examined, it was found that they contain a lot of carbon nanotubes. And on that, Robert Curl, the Nobel Laureate Chemistry in 1996, made a statement that carbon nanotechnology was much older than carbon nanoscience. For the Damascus sword, Indians produced the raw material, mined ore and exported it. Up to the middle of 18th century, the steel swords depended on this particular material. And when the mines in India stopped, the Indians lost the technology. And finally, I'll bring it to where Professor Sharma has given a comment, the material prosperity. And this is the picture from the Angus Madison. It tells you about the contribution of India to the world GDP. And this is the pink portion. Is the contribution of India. This brown one is the contribution of China. And up to 1700, as he said, India was contributing up to 30-40%. Of course, here in the initial stages, it was about 50%, but at least until the 17th century, we were contributing 40%. And this was the work of this chemists, metallurgists, the artisans, and all those trades which were developed around chemistry and metallurgy. And then we lose out from 1870 onwards. Now, this is my concluding remark. The development of chemical sciences in India, well, there was a remarkable progress in material science, metallurgy, including atomistic basis of chemistry, extraction, preparation, purification, characterization, and application of metals, alloys, and chemical compounds, and chemical processes such as calcination, sublimation, distillation, steaming, fixation, casting, etc. for large-scale production. And in several of these endeavors, the Indian chemists were far ahead of their counterparts elsewhere in the world. With this, I would like to, since I have collected material from a lot of sources, but the audience can simply refer to Acharya Praful Chandra Ray's 2 books, Volume 1 and Volume 2 of History of Hindu Chemistry. And in the preface of Volume 1, what he writes, I'm going to bring it to you. And this is what he said. The Indian nation with its glorious past and vast talent potentialities, may yet look forward to a still glorious future. And if the perusal of these pages will have the effect of stimulating my countrymen to strive to regain their old position in the intellectual hierarchy of nations, I shall not have labored in vain. And that is the message that we all need to take from this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor, for wonderfully, you know, taking us through the ancient times. And so you have clearly described, like, you know, at different timescales, like how exactly the chemistry developed. So you have also clearly, you know, highlighted how important it is to communicate to the common people, like, you know, so very simple words, but very clear and accurate information. So we have actually a lot of questions, and before going into these questions, maybe if a panelist has any comments or you know, questions, so maybe we can take that, then we take one or two questions from the audience. Anyone from the panel?
Just have one comment. The word rasa, actually, it gets defined even in Sushruta Samhita.
Yes.
It is not that the rasa appears, say, at the tantric period.
So rasa as mercury, they're strongly referred in the tantric period. That's what I
Yeah, rasa as mercury gets that connotation in the tantric period. Of course.
Yes. See, in the initial period of chemistry, rasa would mean gold. In the Vedic period, they would use rasa for the gold. But the gold lost the luster by the tantric period, and the mercury became the element of choice for experiments. So mercury became rasa.
That is true. I mean, that is true. And one more comment. It is Rasa Prakasha Sudhakara of Yashodhara that you quoted about, I have done this experiment myself. Oh, and I verified the details.
Great, great.
It's not Rasakalpa. It is Rasaprakasha Sudhakara.
Rasaprakasha Sudhakara. Mm.
Okay, thank you.
Wonderful. Yeah. So there are a lot of questions, but I think I will take only few and then some, maybe summarize them and ask a question. So there was a question, right, you know, in the context of COVID. Somebody, Chandrachud Menon, and he was at BARC also. Right now he's heading President Indian Society of Analytical Sciences, Mumbai, Scientist Mumbai. So he says that, you know, there are Ayurveda is, you know, some of the things are very well known and used for a long time. There are, you know, fairly we have enough idea and, you know, idea that these are not at least harmful. But there are a lot of.
Professor Reddy, I have a suggestion. This question, if it is on Ayurveda, then Professor
Hoss okay, sure.
is the right person to take. Okay. And if it is COVID, then that would fit there.
Okay, yeah. So the question is, I think I will just say, maybe we can take it later. So the modern chemicals, you know, the drugs have side effects, but we are considering them for, you know, emergency trials, but not some of these. That was the question. So I think we will move on. And then there are questions like, you know, where do we actually get these information? Like, you know, where are these stored in the library or...
Yes, this Acharya Praful Chandra raised two volumes of History of Hindu Chemistry. And this Hindu is not a communal word there, mind you. There is European chemistry, there is Egyptian chemistry, there is Syrian chemistry, there is Chinese chemistry. So the chemistry evolved in this part of the world is Hindu chemistry, that is all. Okay, so these two volumes are available on the internet, freely downloadable. You download them, start reading. And from there, you can go to the back references. And many of these manuscripts are now available with the Sanskrit and English translation. So it's not very difficult to lay your hands on the materials.
Okay, so another question is, you know, in olden days, in those times, especially there was no concept of atom as such, you know, the details that we know, people did not know. So how did they basically, like, you know, perceive this atom and
Kana indeed talks about the atom as the smallest particle. What I showed you was that we talk only of Kanada, very important contribution, but the other chemist or physicist or whosoever were the scientists that time, they were also wondering about it, and Varahamihira is one who wanted to experiment on it. See, it's that, that's the courage that one has to see. And he uses, see, he goes wrong by three orders of magnitude, but it doesn't matter. I mean, there is that inquiry that, well, can I see it? And finally, he ends up in doing light scattering experiments and arrives at the particle of the aerosol particle. I find it really amazing that somebody thinks in the 4th century. So these concepts existed. Let me also add here that in the tantric period, as I said, that it was a mixture of chemical sciences with the tantric cult in the worship of Shiva and Parvati. See how the concepts were developed. Mercuric sulfide HGS, they described mercury as Shiva, sulfur as Parvati. Look, this is a positive ion, negative ion. They did not go to that level. But they said, there is Shiva, this is Parvati. But then there is a next statement is, if Shiva and Parvati come together, then that is Amrita, and therefore HGS should be good for health. I mean, so that's the way the connections were made. But they were very close to that, those concepts. But these were all empirical, and therefore, we cannot say that why did they not think about it. Even if you take the modern science, the Mach was opposed to the idea of atom right in the 19th century. So there's nothing like that there are no people who are not opposed to this. So this debate always has been there. Now, in the perspective of what we know in this century, if we start looking at, oh, in the century they did not do this, then that would be really very brave statement to make.
Yes, they were much ahead of the time, so that is
yes,
more important.
Yes.
And I think for now, I think for us, how we keep ahead of the time, so I think that is our right now. So another thing is, you know, Rasayana Nakshatra Malika. So Shilpa Kode wants to know more details about this. Have any
comments? Yeah, I mean, the best thing is, I also have been collecting many of these manuscripts from the internet. So I type in the name of the book, and if I know the name of the author, and then either you will get some book on the Amazon, and these are not very expensive, 200, 300 rupees or something like that, or you will get a downloadable PDF file. Just get these names, and you can download easily. But I must also tell you, first time when you download, don't download fully Sanskrit manuscript. Download with the English translation. That's very important. And the translation done by somebody who knows Sanskrit and also knows, has some science background. Otherwise, there will be some issues.
Yeah, Professor. Thank you, Professor Jagadab. So yeah, there are a lot of questions. I am sorry, I am not able to read through more than 60 questions, and it is only.
Oh.
So we move to the next talk. So Vivek, so can we now go to the next talk? Thank you very
yes,
much.
Yes. Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Malla, and thank you very much, Professor Jagadab. I think it was amazing talk. I myself learned lots of things, and I think there is too many things to really invest using the modern techniques of chemistry. I think this is amazing. I really wanted to hear you for another 1 hour, but since we have 4 more speakers, we have to.
Oh, sure.